Okay, so this is my last lecture on this stability issue for geometric inequalities. So let me recall what we did. We proved the superimmetric inequality, and then we saw two approaches to stability. There was one approach by Fuglede, which was the idea of studying the case where you have a set which is very close to the boundary of the sphere, and we showed by a kind of direct computation that there is a stability inequality. Then we had a different approach for the general case using mass transport. And so now what I would like just to mention briefly, it's another strategy to get the stability result for the isoperimetric inequality, and then I'm gonna move to a different problem. So these kind of stability results in general, I don't have probably much time to discuss about applications, but they appear in several problems. I actually sent yesterday to Claudio some notes where you can find some applications of these results. They appear, for instance, sometimes in variational problem from calculus of variation, but also you can prove stability results not only for. So here we are dealing with stability for isoperimetric inequalities we did up to now. I'm gonna discuss briefly in the next hours the case of Brun-Minkowski. I think these two cases show some different type of ideas that you can use to study these problems, but ideas of the same spirit can be used to study stability results for Sobolev inequalities. And maybe Gagliardo-Nirenberg. So these are functional type inequalities, inequalities where you use the gradient to control the norm, which is in the spirit of Sobolev. And for instance, stability inequalities for this kind of inequalities can be used to study asymptotic behaviors. So, for application, these are used in asymptotic behavior of solutions to parabolic PDEs. And my isoperimetric inequality, for instance, they appear naturally in stability results let's say, in general, in variational problems. So in the notes that I gave to Claudio, there is some discussion in one of them about applications of this stability inequality in variational problems. Problem coming actually from to study the shape of crystals. While in another note, there are some stability results for Gagliardo-Nirenberg inequality, which can be used to study long-time behavior of solutions to parabolic PDEs. So this is just to mention some possible applications. Something which happens, I can tell you as an experience, in these problems is that unfortunately there is no universal method to prove stability. Like, whenever you have a new problem, if you're lucky, some variant of known methods work, but sometimes you just have to start from scratch and find a completely new approach, which is gonna be exactly the point now for the Brun-Minkowski. So just very briefly, just in 10 minutes, I would like to mention an approach for isoperimetric inequality which works for the classical isoperimetric inequality, wouldn't work for the anisotropic case. And this kind of connects also with what you saw in Emanuele's lecture, because he used regularity theory for minimal surfaces. So let's say, so another approach for stability of isoperimetric inequalities. So this approach had been started and then, I mean, improved with time, but I think the first one who used this in this context has been Chicalese and Leonardi around 2011. So the idea is the following. The idea is that you want to prove, remember, something like the deficit of a set controls up to a constant the symmetry square. So this is what you want to prove. So you say, okay, suppose that by contradiction there exists a sequence EK such that, so we have the volume fixed, EK equal the volume B1, such that delta EK over a symmetry of EK square is going to zero. So you have a sequence which contradicts your inequality. Then you say, okay, what's the idea? The idea is that I know Fugledi result. Fugledi tells me that if I am a smooth, nice smooth perturbation of the sphere, the result is true. So if I could show that this sequence, EK, was at some moment of this form, I would get a contradiction. The problem is that a priori I have no information on this sequence. They're completely random set. I mean, it's easy to see that they're not of that form because if you give me a set EK, no matter how it looks like, I can always, for instance, add a very small tentacle. And so even if this was EK, I can add a small tentacle, this would be, I can do this in such a way that deficit is almost the same, the asymmetry is almost the same. And so you see that this new set EK will still be a set which satisfies this property, but it's very rough. So I'm saying a set which satisfies something like this a priori has no regularity. It could be extremely rough. On the other end, I could do the following. I would say, okay, I have a family like this, which is, I mean, I have a family EK which is doing this. Let me replace EK by a new set FK, where FK is a minimizer of the following function. Minimum of volume of F equal 1. So I have the volume constraint. Sorry, B1. So I have the volume constraint. And then I say, let me fix the asymmetry of FK to be equal to the asymmetry of EK. So asymmetry of F equal asymmetry of EK. And you minimize delta of F. So you say, among all sets which have this denominator fixed, let me minimize the denominator. Okay? I can do this. And you have, so this function is what? This is nothing else than the perimeter of F minus the perimeter of the unit ball. So really what I'm minimizing is kind of the perimeter with an asymmetric constraint. So I'm minimizing the perimeter among all sets which have the same volume B1 and some fixed asymmetry. And so this FK, but of course, have a deficit which is less than the deficit via minimizer, delta FK is less or equal than delta EK. So in particular, since the asymmetries are the same, I have this. And this was going to zero. So also these sets have this ratio going to zero. But now these are less random set because FK is constructed as a minimizer of some variational problem. So maybe I could hope that these sets now are smoother because they're minimizer of the perimeter. The problem is that I have some constraints which are kind of annoying. So if it was just minimizing the perimeter with volume constraint, well, the minimizer, okay, would be a ball, but in some sense, you can hope that, okay, this constraint doesn't mess up too much with the regularity. It's kind of difficult to work directly with that constraint. So instead of putting a constraint, so the difficulty here of this approach is to prove that FK is smooth. So when you have this kind of problems where you have a constraint like this and you don't really know how to deal with it, you can try to say, okay, let me not force the constraint completely. Let me just force it. Let me just put it as a penalization term. So try another, a weaker approach, in some sense. You say, okay, this constraint, it really kind of bothers me. I don't know how to deal with it. So instead of minimizing that, I'm gonna minimize delta of f plus a of f minus a of ek, where I just put the volume constraint now. So instead of putting this, imposing that this is zero, I kind of remove it and I put it as an additional term in the function, which means that whenever AF is not the same as EK, I pay something. Okay? So why this? And so define, let now FK be a minimizer of this. So I started with FK minimizer of this, and I discovered that this is not bad, but I don't know how to prove regularity. So I say, okay, let's forget this. Let's try this one. Let's say FK be now a minimizer of this. What do I need? I need to make sure that this is still satisfied. But, so if FK is a minimizer, so what do I have? I have that delta of FK plus A of FK minus A of EK is less or equal to delta of EK, which, remember, then delta is just perimeter of minus the perimeter of unit ball. I can add the perimeter of the unit ball of both sides, and you get this, actually. Just because delta is the same as the perimeter up to a constant. So on the right, so you get this by minimality. And now perimeter of EK, so this is delta of EK plus perimeter of the unit ball. And this, it's what? It's a little, actually, since this is going to zero, I know that this is bounded by perimeter of the unit ball plus a small constant, which is gonna be small, but I don't even care, asymmetry of EK squared. This comes from this. Right? The delta is controlled by AK square. And now here, the perimeter of FK by the isoperimetric inequality, just the classic isoperimetric inequality, for sure is greater than the perimeter of the unit ball. Right? FK is a guy which has measure equal to the unit ball, so its perimeter is greater or equal. So when you compare this, you see that this plus this term is less or equal than this, you discover, you simplify the perimeters, and then you discover that AFK minus AEK is less or equal than constant AEK square, which tells you that when EK, the symmetry is very small, you see that the symmetry of FK is kind of comparable. So you have to think that the symmetry is very small. So this is a lower order, much smaller than this. Right? So this is telling me, if you have small numbers, this is telling you that up to constants like something of this form, you have that, so for K large enough, I will have something like this. Right? Give me three numbers, and you have that this is small. Then as this goes to zero, at some moment, you will have something like this. So it means that the symmetry, okay, is not the same, but they're comparable. So, of course, I can just go back here, right? I will not have something like this. I will have maybe a factor 4 in front, because the symmetry now, the ratio between these two is bounded by factor 4. So the symmetry are not the same, right? So I have, of course, delta of this is less than delta of this. It's just this inequality, right? So I have that now still. So delta FK over AK AFK square is going to zero. But now for this functional, what am I really doing? So let me rewrite it again. So since the deficit Again, what is the definition? Perimeter minus perimeter of the ball. Perimeter of the ball is just a constant, so it doesn't count. So FK is a minimizer of this, as we say. Perimeter of F plus A of F minus A of EK with volume of F fixed. Okay, so this, what is this? This is like you are minimizing the perimeter plus some other term with a volume constraint. So the volume constraint is really not that difficult to handle. Like, let's forget for a second. So forget for a second that and think that you're minimizing something like this. You're minimizing perimeter plus this term. What's the key point? The point is that this term, so this is a perimeter term, and this is volume kind, volume type. These are measures. It's about measures. The symmetry is a measure. So what you can, in some sense, your the graph. So if you take like the boundary of F locally, and you take a ball of radius R, and then you say, okay, let me compare the perimeter of F with the perimeter of some set. So let me use a different color. So you take this set, you call it G. So this is the boundary of G. So you take, so let G be such that G delta F is containing some ball BR. So this is a ball of radius R. So you have a set which is with a perturbation of F only inside the ball, then by you can use G as a test here, and you get that the perimeter, you know that the perimeter of FK, sorry, this was FK, FK plus the asymmetry of FK minus the asymmetry of EK is less or equal than the perimeter of G plus asymmetry of G minus the asymmetry of EK, and then you take this guy here, and the point is that since F and G differ only inside this ball, you get an information of this form. Perimeter of FK is less or equal than perimeter of G minus the difference between these two guys. But so these asymmetries is something like this, right? This is like FK delta, this is the volume of the difference between FK and B1, and this is, roughly speaking, the difference between G and B1. So if you do this minus this, you can control this with F delta G, the difference between the volume of F and G, this term minus this term. And this is like R to the power, is controlled by R to the N, because they differ only in a ball of radius R. So this is, let me really keep going here. So what we discover is that the perimeter of FK is less or equal than perimeter of G plus a constant R to the N for every G such that F delta G is contained in some ball of radius R around some point X dot. So when you perturb your graph, your set, it doesn't matter if it's a graph, this set could be completely rough, it doesn't matter. But whatever perturbation you do, the perimeter of F is minimal up to R to the N. And R to the N is kind of lower order with respect to the perimeter, because the perimeter inside a ball of radius R, roughly speaking, is R to the N minus 1, the perimeter of a set inside a ball of radius R. So here I'm saying that this set is almost a minimizer of the perimeter functional up to a lower, so this is lower order term with respect to the perimeter. So this is not, what do I want to say? I'm saying F, what I want to say, the boundary of K is not a minimal surface. It's not the minimal surface that you saw in Emanuele's class. Okay, in this case, he had codimension, I mean, this is codimension one. Emanuele had arbitrary codimension, but he had minimal surfaces, surfaces which minimize the perimeter with fixed boundary condition. He had a surface such as whenever you perturb it, the area has to increase. Here I have a surface which where the perimeter has to increase up to an error. But the error being lower order, it's still enough to develop a regularity theory. So being lower order, so this means that Fk is what is called an almost minimal surface. And since we are in codimension one, now I'm not going to enter into the theory, but so boundary of Fk is n minus one dimensional. So we are, and also we know, since the symmetry is very small, that Fk it's very close to the unit ball. So it means that my set, so here I have the unit ball, and my set Fk a priori could be a very rough perturbation of the ball. This a priori what Fk may look like. But because it's an almost minimal surface, so it satisfies some kind of equation, and here, well, it doesn't matter here that we are in codimension one, it would work. But the fact is an almost minimal surface which is close to a ball actually implies, by the regularity theory, that boundary of Fk is a C1 alpha graph over boundary of V1. So this cannot happen. Actually, your set is not like this. The regularity theory tells you no, your boundary of Fk is this. So here I'm using something deep. I mean, regularity for minimal surface, which are close to a L1 close to something smooth. I mean, there is all a regularity theory developed for this. So here I'm using something deep and high neon trivial. But what's the point is that now my sets satisfy Fourier assumption. My set now are so for k large enough. For k large enough, Fk satisfies Fourier hypothesis, which tells me that delta of Fk is greater or equal than a dimensional constant, the symmetry of Fk square. But it's a contradiction, because we're assuming that, remember, delta of Fk over a symmetry or AFK square was going to zero. So in some sense, I suppose that my sets were not good for that. I replaced them. So I started from sets EK, which were completely random. I didn't know what they looked like. I replaced them by new sets, which still satisfied the fact that this ratio was going to zero, but they were smoother. And then for the particular class, and then I could show that these sets were like smooth perturbation of the sphere. And then for smooth perturbation of the sphere, the result is true, so I get a contradiction. So this is kind of approach which is, I don't know, very efficient. Gives you, in some sense, it tells you the only thing you have to check when you want to prove stability is when you have a smooth perturbation of the sphere. In some sense, Fourier case is the only one to check, because all the rest you can get by this kind of abstract machinery compactness argument. You use something deep, like the regularity theory. And it's, let's say, more direct, but for some aspects it's less elementary, so because you use deeper results. But it works in several other problems. Now, to show you that the theory is not over, and in some sense it's not that the methods you saw, like this one, developing in the around the minimizer, or using an optimal transport map, it's more or less, once you have this, you one way or another, you solve a problem. I give you another problem where any approach that I've I mean, that I described to you, but also anyone else I knew up to now, just fail, unfortunately. Or fortunately, because then you have to think something new, which is interesting. So let's start with a different problem, which is Brun-Minkowski. So Brun-Minkowski is about volumes of sets. So the idea is the following. You have two sets, A and B in Rn. So actually last week, people were here, you already saw what the Brun-Minkowski inequality is because Guido gave a proof of Brun-Minkowski inequality using optimal transport. Let's say, so I have two sets A and B. I'm going to assume that A and B are compact. And I'm going to define their sum, A plus B, to be the set of points of the form x plus y, where x is in A and y is in B. So it's, you start to take all possible sums of points in A and B. So what Brun-Minkowski is about, how can I relate the volume of this guy to the volume of these guys? So it's about relating volumes. So what's the inequality? In one dimension, so in the 1D case, the Brun-Minkowski inequality is very easy, and it tells you that the measure of A plus B is greater or equal than the measure of A plus the measure of B. Let me give you the proof. This is very elementary. So up to a translation, you can assume that the minimum, so these are all these inequalities are translation invariant. You can always translate the sets. The volume, nothing will change in the volumes. So you can assume that the minimum, the minimum of A is zero, and the max of B is zero. So you have this picture. You have the line, you have the origin, A is somewhere here, is some compact set which lives on this half line, and B lives on the left of the origin. Okay? Then you see that A plus B contains, well, in A plus B I can take always A plus 0, because 0 is in B. And then I can also take B, any point in B with 0, because 0 is in A. So you take points of sum of this form. This is just A itself, this is just B itself, and this is a disjoint union. So this is equal to A union B. And you have a disjoint union, so the volume is greater or equal than the volume of the union. But this is, because they're disjoint, the sum of the volumes. Okay? So in one dimension is just this simple trick. Now, what happens in higher dimension? In higher dimension, you will try to see if this is the right inequality. And I tell you no, and actually, a simple way to guess what the right inequality is to test it with balls, because it's an easy example. So what about n greater or equal than 2? So in higher dimension. Let's do an example. Take A to be the ball centered at 0 with radius rho, and B to be the ball center at 0 with radius r, then exercise, so this is example, this exercise, A plus B is nothing else than the ball of radius r plus rho. So if you take a ball and you sum another ball, you just have the sum of the radii. But then, what is the volume? So the volume of A plus B is a dimensional constant times R plus rho to the n. The volume of A is the same dimensional constant, R to the n. And the volume of B is the same dimensional constant, sorry, A was B rho. So this is rho to the n, this is r to the n. So if you want an inequality, which is kind of sharp, at least you would like maybe that, I mean, you hope that you're not doing something completely really not sharp, you see, okay, a good way to have a sharp inequality is to have get powers 1 over n, because then this implies that if I take powers 1 over n, I get this. Because you take powers 1 over n, and then you have r plus rho, r, rho, and r. So this is an equality. So you see, in this special case, you see that both, which usually should be the best sets, usually the minimizer for every inequality, especially with so many three symmetries, if you want a sharp inequality on both, you need to take powers 1 over n. Otherwise, you don't have equality. So if there is a sharp inequality, it should be something like this. And in fact, the Brun-Minkowski inequality is this. You just put a greater or equal. So theorem. Brun-Minkowski, which is called Brun-Minkowski, but they proved it only for convex sets. So I think Brun proved it and Minkowski did the quality case, but only for convex sets. But the Brun-Minkowski inequality is true for general sets. So A and B compact and non-empty. Then the volume of A plus B, 1 over n, greater or equal than A, 1 over n plus B, 1 over n. Okay. Let me give you a proof of this. So Brun-Minkowski inequality is one of the inequalities that you can't prove by induction. So it's kind of interesting. Actually, just a comment for people who know, there is this fact that Brun-Minkowski is like an inequality of sets. There is an analogous of Brun-Minkowski for functions, which is called Prekopal-Hindler. And then Prekopal-Hindler has the nice feature that it goes up by induction. So in some sense, you can prove Brun-Minkowski, Prekopal-Hindler in one dimension, Prekopal-Hindler in dimension, Brun-Minkowski in a dimension. But if you remain in the space of sets, you cannot go from one dimension to one dimension. There is no induction argument for Brun-Minkowski. But there are elementary proof of this, which I'm going to show you. It's kind of neat and cute, the proof of this, is by approximation and induction. So you start from the case. So let's do the case where A and B are boxes with parallel sides. Parallel sides. So just to do a picture, this is my A, and this is my B, okay? Boxes with parallel sides. And let's say that the sides, so sides of A, they have length A1, AN. Let me call this the length of the different sides. So in this way, this case would be A1, A2, B1, B2. So sides of B, they have the length B1, BN. Okay, so you have two boxes, and this is the length of the sides. So what do we want to prove? We want to prove that we want to prove this inequality. So I'm gonna look what is this. So I want to prove that this quantity is less or equal than 1. What is this quantity? This is equal, so the volume of A is the product of the I, and the volume of A plus B, okay, other exercise, so A, if you do A plus B, that would be a box with sides A1 plus B1, AN plus BN, right? So if you have this, A plus B will have the sum of sides, A1 plus B1 and AN plus BN.
And you assume
parallel
rectangular angle.
Boxes, these are rectangle cubes, parallel people.
Yeah, okay. But you can't
is a box for me.
Okay.
This is not a box.
Okay.
Yeah, in box, in my definition of box means like okay. this picture. And so the sum, of course, the side just adds. So I get AI plus BI. And I have 1 over N plus the same product of BI, product AI plus BI, 1 over N. And the good thing about products is that if you have products on the top and products on the bottom, you can just put the product in front and have. So this is the same as product of AI plus BI, 1 over N, plus product BI, AI plus BI, 1 over N. And now we already saw it. We used it last time, arithmetic geometric inequality. It's always the same. So arithmetic mean, geometric mean inequality tells me that the product to the power 1 over n is less than the average. So this is less than 1 over n sum over I AI, AI plus BI. And then I get the same here, plus 1 over n sum over I of BI, AI plus BI. So I apply to each of them arithmetic geometric inequality. Now we just put the sum together. 1 over n sum over I, what I have, AI divided by I plus BI plus BI, AI plus BI. So I have AI plus BI over AI plus BI, which is just 1. And the sum goes from 1 to n. So you have 1 over n sum from 1 to n of 1. So you get 1, which was the inequality I wanted. So Brumminkowski inequality for boxes is nothing else than arithmetic geometric inequality. So this is first case. Okay. Now, how do I do the general case? The general case is done by induction on the total number of boxes. So, 2, we do induction over the number of boxes which compose A and B. So you, they say A has 100 boxes and B has 200, so the total number of boxes is 300. Okay, and I do induction on the total number of boxes I have. So I did the case where there are 2 boxes. A is 1, B is 1. And now I do induction over the total. So the next case would be 3 boxes. So if I have 3 boxes, at least one of the 2 must have 2 boxes. So let's say, without loss of generality, A has at least 2 boxes. So number of boxes are all disjoint. So induction with the number of boxes, all boxes are disjoint. I mean, respectively for A and B. I'm not, so A cannot be this. This is not admissible. A can be something like this. So this is not, this is okay. So these are disjoint boxes. So if A is at least 2 boxes, these are disjoint, and again, I didn't write down, but boxes and my boxes are always parallel to each other. So number, these are all parallel. All boxes are disjoint and parallel. So something like this. The axes are all parallel. So since the boxes are disjoint, I can always find one cut. So I can find one coordinate hyperplane. Hyperplane which splits A as the union of as 2 sets A1 disjoint union A minus, where these are again union of boxes. So let me draw a picture to show you what I mean. It's easier to draw than to write. And to see what's going on. So I'm just saying that because this joint, I can always find an hyperplane which could be the vertical one or the horizontal one, but one of the coordinate hyperplane, let's say this one, such that certain number of boxes of A is here, and another number of boxes of A is here. So this hyperplane is not allowed to cut any box, A minus. I can find an hyperplane which splits my set A, so this is my set A, which splits A minus and A plus, and I have at least one box on the left and one box on the right. Okay? So at this level, I didn't cut, so here, the hyperplane touch no boxes, so. No, 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 this is not a missing one. In the assumption, they are non-empty. So I am doing number of boxes. I mean, also because when you do the Minkowski sum of a set with an empty set, you get empty set, so it's not very interesting. So the hyperplane does not intersect A. Okay. So I'm finding an hyperplane which does not intersect A and split my A in two sets. Now let me draw B. This is my B. Now I'm going to take another hyperplane. This one, so I should find a hyperplane parallel to the previous one, so that the following happens. So let me use colors to show this. So maybe this hyperplane, I take an hyperplane vertical, and I define B plus to be what is on the left. So here I can cut boxes. I can define B plus to be this. Then I call B minus what is on the right. So this is B minus. And I choose it, the previous one, so that the fraction of B which is on the left is the same as the fraction of A which was on the left. So the volume of A plus over A is equal to the volume of B plus over B. So what I did is the following. I say, okay, I cut first, and let's say that I have 40% of the mass here and 60% of the volume here. Then I take an hyperplane and I start to move it. And I look how much fraction of volume I have on the left with respect to the right. I stop when I have 40% here and 60% here. This is my hyperplane. Is a ratio.
Ah, okay.
It's the ratio between the two. So it's just a matter of percentage. I want to make sure that the ratio on the left here is the same as the ratio on the left here. And now I just do induction. So without loss of generality, up to a translation. In that sense, now I redo the argument that I did in one dimension. So up to a translation. We can assume that both hyperplanes coincide with, let's say, x1 equals 0. So these are both hyperplanes x1 equals 0. And then what happens? You see immediately, then A plus plus B plus is disjoint from A minus plus B minus. In the sense that if I take a point here and a point here, the sum will have coordinate less or equal than 0. If I take a point here and a point here, the sum will have coordinate greater or equal than 0. So sums of points which are both on the left will remain on the left. Some points which are both on the right remain to the right, so in particular the sets are disjoint. Okay? I mean, this is always true that they are disjoint. I mean, I just mean, I didn't need to do a translation to say that they were disjoint. It was just easier to visualize if I tell you that they're both x1 equals 0. So in this way, x1 is less or equal than 0 here. So this is contained in x1 less or equal than 0. And this is contained in x1 greater or equal than 0. Okay, so now I say, then the volume of a plus b is greater or equal than the volume of a plus plus b plus plus the volume of a minus plus b minus. Just because these sets are disjoint. And of course, each of these sets is contained here. This is contained here, this is contained here, so the sum is contained, and same here. Right? These are disjoint and they're both contained in plus b. And now just apply the induct. So now the point is that since I split A without counting boxes, so you see that the number of boxes of A plus is strictly less than the number of boxes in A. Number of boxes of A minus is strictly less than the number of A. The number of boxes in B plus is just less or equal. I don't know if they decrease it because I cut. So maybe when I cut it, I created new boxes. So in fact, it's possible that I didn't, the number of boxes is the same for B. So think that B was this. Then with the cut, I would have still one box and one box. Okay, so it didn't decrease, it didn't increase at least. And same for B minus. So I can apply the inductive hypothesis, because now the sum of the boxes of A plus plus B plus is strictly less than this. Same for this, because here I set strict inequalities. So by induction, I know that the result is true for A plus and B plus. Okay, maybe let me do it here. So by induction, A plus plus B plus is greater or equal than A plus 1 over n plus B plus 1 over n power n. And now, here is the moment where it's crucial that I chose the ratios in this way, because now this is what? This is A plus, which multiplies 1 plus B plus over A plus 1 over n power n. But this, by this choice, this is the same as A over B. So this is exactly the same if I replace here A plus 1 plus B over A 1 over n to the power n. Okay? And now you observe the same is true for A minus and B minus, because of course this ratio like this implies the same if I put A minus and B minus. If this is, if it was 40 and 40 on the left, it's going to be 6 and 60 on the right. So the proportion on the left implies the proportion on the right is the same. So I get also from A minus plus B minus, I get, so here I'm using that A minus over A is also equal to B minus over B, which is just an immediate consequence of that. And so you get here A minus 1 plus B 1 over N, A 1 over N, to the power N. So the same inequality, but with the minus. And now you just add the inequalities, and you are done. So then you get that A plus B is greater or equal than the sum. So A plus plus A minus 1 plus B 1 over N A 1 over N power N. And that's A. And so we get the inequality. So this proves that this proves that the result is true whenever A and B are finite union of boxes. The number is as large as you want, because by induction you have as many boxes. And then by approximation you get the general compact case. So general compact set, there is an arguable approximation. So you approximate compact sets with finite union of a lot of boxes, you apply the result, and you pass to the limit. Okay. Okay, I'm going to stop in a second, and then next hour we're going to discuss the stability, but let me mention two interesting facts. One is an interesting remark, I think, that if you've never seen it, it's useful to know. So, Brun-Minkowski is one of the strongest inequalities for geometry for this kind of geometric setting. For instance, Brun-Minkowski implies the isoperimetric inequality, also the anisotropic one. So, remark one is that Brun-Minkowski implies isoperimetric inequality, also anisotropic. How do you show this? At least for most sets, you say, okay, let me do directly the anisotropic case. If you remember the definition of yesterday, what was the anisotropic perimeter? That's the limit for epsilon going to zero of the volume of E plus epsilon K minus E over epsilon. For a perimeter, remember, if the classical perimeter corresponds to K equal the unit ball. Okay, so classical perimeter means K equal B1. Okay, now what do we have? We have A, so this was the epsilon neighborhood, if you remember yesterday, no, 2 days ago. This was the epsilon neighborhood, if you look at the notes. And now we have a sum, Minkowski sum. And the Minkowski inequality tells me that the volume of this is greater or equal than the volume of E, 1 over n, plus the volume of this, 1 over n. What is the volume of this? You know, the volume of epsilon k, 1 over n, power n, minus E over epsilon, limit as epsilon goes to 0. But then this is a volume to the power 1 over n, so it's one homogeneous. The volume scales power n, but then you have 1 over n outside, so the epsilon goes out. So this is limit as epsilon goes to 0, E 1 over n plus epsilon k 1 over n power n minus volume of E over epsilon. Compute the limit. This is n measure of k 1 over n E n minus 1 over n. So this is the isoperimetric inequality which have constant. So this is the first remark. So you see also why Brun-Minkowski is interesting. I mean, it implies isoperimetric inequality in one line. A second remark is the quality case that is not obvious from the proof. But I'm going to mention to you, and then we're going to see more later in the stability. So if A plus B to the power 1 over n is equal to A 1 over n plus B 1 over n, then this means that A and B are convex and they are homothetic. So this means that A is equal to the form lambda B plus X dot for some lambda positive and X dot in Rn. So the only way, actually this is a different leaf. So equality in Brun-Minkowski happens if and only if both sets are convex, and actually they are the same convex set up to dilation. Okay, so let me stop here. We can take a 10 minutes break. So up to 07, this is 57 now. And then we start again. Okay, so what I would like to discuss now is the stability for Brumminkowski. So it's not very easy from any approximation. Whenever you have a proof which is not done directly, so you have to argue by approximation, induction, whatever, it's very difficult to even understand the quality case. So to understand the quality case, I would just like to remember in really 5 minutes almost the proof by optimal transport, and which kind of make you understand a bit why things work, but it's gonna be useless for stability, and we'll see why. So proof of Brumminkowski by optimal transport. Well, it's not going to be useless, but let's say it's going to be useless for the general case. So Guido gave a proof last week based on some displacement convexity inequality. Let me just give a direct proof, which is more or less a copy of what I already did the last time for the superimmetric inequality. So you have your set A, you have your set B, and you associate two probability measures to A and B. So uniform density in A, uniform density in B. Now you take the optimal transport map T equal grad phi, which sends mu onto nu. So T push forward mu equal nu. Phi is convex. And we have that the determinant of grad T is B over A. Now the observation that you can make is the following, that so T is sending A onto B, so T of A is equal to B, which implies that if I take the set, so let's consider this set, identity plus T of A. So the image of A through the map identity plus T, which is the set of points of the form X plus T of X, where X is in A. So this set, so this is in A, this is in B, because points in A are sent to B, so this is contained in A plus B. So what I can say is that the volume of A plus B is greater or equal than the volume of this set, which is what? Is the integral over A of the Jacobian of this map. So determinant of identity plus grad T. But now grad T is, remember, the Hessian of phi, because T is grad phi. And now the observation, which is always based on some arithmetic geometric inequality, I mean, that's all you have, is the following, if you want, exercise. If you give me non-negative numbers, let's say a1, an non-negative, then the product of 1 plus ai is greater or equal, I from 1 to n, is greater or equal than 1 plus the product of the i, 1 over n, power n. So let's apply this inequality there. So what is here the determinant? So determinant of identity plus Hessian of phi is the product, if I call lambda I the eigenvalues of the Hessian of phi, this is the product of 1 plus lambda I, right? Because you just diagonalize the matrix, and when it's diagonal, it's just the product. Then here, this is greater or equal by the inequality 1 plus the product of the lambda I, 1 over n power n. But this is what? This is the determinant of Hessian of phi, which is the determinant of grad T, and this is B over A. Because that's the, remember, determinant of grad T was B over A. This is the determinant of the transform map. And so here what we get is, so I go back here and I say this is greater or equal than the integral over A of 1 plus determinant power 1 over n, so B over A 1 over n power n outside. And this is a constant function, so you get volume of A 1 plus B over A 1 over n. Let me cancel this. Power n. Okay? So it's a very direct proof where there are only two inequalities. And so that's cute. But what about now if I want to use it for stability? So yes, 2 days ago we saw that the optimal transport proof for the superimmersive inequality was very efficient to prove stability. So stability issue. So the question is the following. I'm gonna assume, let's say that the volume of A and B is bounded by two constants that I'm gonna call little lambda and capital lambda. So I just want my sets not to be too small or too big. So I trap their volume in some range. So Brumikowski is not scale invariant, so this is not a free assumption. I'm gonna make it as an assumption. I'm gonna assume my sets are neither too small nor too big, right? And for every, once I put a bound on the volumes, I want to show that the error in Brumikowski estimates how far they are from each other. So I define delta of A and B, my deficit, to be the error in Brumikowski and I would like to measure how far they are from each other. But in fact, there are two things that I want to measure. Because what is the quality case? The quality case tells me that they are homothetic, but also they are convex. So I would like delta to measure not only how far they are from each other in shape, but also how far they are from being convex. So let me define the following quant. So for simplicity, anyhow, we will not have time to look at general case. So for simplicity, let's assume. So this is a simplification, it's not without loss of generality. I'm just doing for simplicity. Let's assume that they have the same volume. Okay? And so I'm gonna define, first of all, the standard one distance. So alpha on the A and beta, A and B, is the infimum among all translation of A delta x plus B. So how far they are in L1 up to a translation. So this is what measures how far they are from B homothetic. So theorem is something we proved with Francesco and Aldo in 09. Was that if you already assume that A and B are convex, then alpha A and B is controlled by a constant square root of delta A B. So if, in some sense, you get rid of the convexity part, you say, I don't want to worry about the proving that Brumikowski implies convexity, so I'm going to assume already they're convex, then I can get a stability inequality, and proof uses the optimal transport proof. So it's actually even easier than the one I gave you 2 days ago. It's the same kind of strategy that the one I gave you 2 days ago with optimal with a superimmetric inequality. But in some sense, it's easier because the sets are convex. You don't have that problem of last time where I had sets which could have something like this. Because now sets are convex. So this disappears for free. So this is not the point of what I want to say. So the kind of stability result for this part is the same strategy. So that's a case where a strategy works for a supermetric inequality works for Ruminkowski. But actually, let's now wonder what can we say when the set is not convex. So I want to treat the general case now. So I don't want to assume convexity. And as we'll see, the problem is already complicated in very simple cases. So let's assume, again, to simplify, A equal B. So we simplify even more life. Now the sets are already the same. So if the sets are the same, I don't have to show that they're homothetic. That part is taken care of. But now I want to show that they are convex. So what is now delta? So delta of A, now it's volume of A plus A, 1 over N, minus twice the volume of A, 1 over N. So this is my deficit. So I take the sum of A with itself. So sum of A with itself is not the same as A, because so A plus A is the set of points of the form X plus X prime, where X and X prime are in A. So in some sense, you're taking sum of different points. And in general, you get more. This set is bigger than just deleting. So what is the goal? So goal, I would like to use delta of A to control the measure of the distance of A from its convex hull. So co of A is my convex hull of A. So I would like to use the deficit in Ruminkowski to show that my set is almost convex, right? Okay, so let me tell you already just a philosophical comment why the optimal transport proof cannot give you anything, just because the optimal transport proof, it's an empty proof when A is equal to B. Because if you're sending A onto A, the transport map is the identity, and you're not doing anything. You're just transporting a set to itself, and you're just doing trivial inequalities. So the proof I gave, which had a meaning for different sets, in some sense for same sets, is not telling you anything. It's not adding structure to the problem, because you're just transporting a set to itself. There is nothing deep behind it. So when we tried, when we were working on this problem with Aldo and Francesco, we tried for several months, actually, to try to understand the general case, A and B, and we realized that we couldn't do it. Then we said, okay, let's try the stupid case, because you always think that this is a stupid case, dimension one, and at least just to feel better with yourself, you say, let me do a simple case, at least if I can do it, I feel a bit better after wasting last 2 months proving nothing. And we tried that for probably another month, and we're still stuck. Then we said, okay, let's do one dimension, A equal B. Right? The easiest possible case you can think of. We tried probably another month at least, and then we just gave up. Too difficult for us. No way. We had no clue how to do that. We were just getting crazy. And it was at that moment where I was in Los Angeles that I was lucky to meet an analyst who knows arithmetic, and so I was chatting with Terence Tao, who told me that the one-dimensional case is known and is a theorem in additive combinatorics from the 60s. Good. I take the book, look at the theorem, like 12 pages proof, you get the one-dimensional stability result. Use a lot of machinery, you have subgroups, greater common divisor, and stuff which are not, it's not like standard when you work with these kind of problems. Because the point is that the result is not, I mean, the result in additive combinatorics is not a result about sets in R. The result in additive combinatorics is a result about set in Z. But then you think, okay, if I have a set in R, I discretize it with intervals, and then to each interval I isolate a point, and then I get a set in Z, and then the problem becomes a problem in Z. But the problem in Z has much more structure than just the problem in R, because in Z you have to deal with the fact that points have holes in between. What do I mean? Take an interval in R, multiply by 2, you get an interval. take a set full in z's, I mean 0, 1 until 10, multiply by 2, you get 0, 2, 4, 6, 8. So in some sense, being full is not something which is stable in z. What is stable in z is to be an arithmetic progression. That is something that you preserve when you multiply. So in z, the family of convex sets of intervals becomes all the arithmetic progressions, but the arithmetic progressions, you have a lot of them, and you have to kind of quotient every time if you want to have like a canonical guy by the greater common divisor. You have a greater progression divided by the greater common divisor, you remove the holes. So this presence of the greater common divisor everywhere makes the proof much more complicated. Anyhow, so let me show you now the one-dimensional proof. It's not 12 pages because if you only want the result in R, you can actually simplify it because we want to prove something which is less. So let me make you, let me start with an example. So we are dimension n equal 1, and I'm going to take the following example. So I take the set, a set which is union of two intervals of length 1 half. So 1 half. Ah, okay, sorry. Delta of A, I'm going to assume here. Let me normalize the volume. Otherwise, this is not scale invariant, so let me normalize the volume. So let me take A to be union of two intervals. Then if you do, let's consider A plus A over, done in this way. A plus A over 2. So this means that you take x plus x prime over 2. So you have to take convex combination. So you take points, what is a plus a over 2? You take points here, you do the convex combination, you get this. You take points here, you do convex combination, you get this. And then you take a point here and a point here, you do the convex combination, you get another interval. So you get 1 half length, 1 half, 1 half. So the measure of a plus a is twice the measure of a plus a over 2. And this is 3 halves, so this is 3. Okay? So delta of a, which is, here n is 1. So delta of a, which is a plus a minus 2, the measure of a, in this case is 1. And you see that the convex hull of a minus a is as large as you want, because you can always take these intervals and put them very far apart. Okay, so this is as large as you want, while this is fixed and is 1. So that's just to say that you cannot prove just delta controls this quantity, because you have a counterexample. So you need delta to be small enough if you want to prove something. And the amazing thing of this additive combinatorics theorem, which is called Feynman theorem. It's, so 59, says the following. So this is a corollary of Feynman theorem. Feynman theorem is about sets in Z. So if A is a set in R with volume 1, let's say, and if delta of A is strictly less than 1, so if I can kill this counterexample, then the measure of the convex hull of A minus A is less or equal than delta A. Okay? So once you kill that counterexample, you have a very sharp stability inequality. It tells you that the distance from your convex hull is controlled with constant 1, power 1, from the deficit. See, there is no square root, there is no constant. It's a very strong result. Okay, so let me show you a bit the argument. So personally, we tried to do something like that by hand, I remember. I mean, we never thought about using the... I mean, I don't know how to prove this result without passing through the integer. That's what I want to claim. I mean, without using the really the result in Z and passing to the limit. I don't have a proof that I three null. Which will be interesting because I don't know. I don't know if what I'm giving you is the simplest possible proof, but that's what you have as of now. So let's prove Feynman. So we start with a lemma, which is called Cauchy-Davenport inequality. So these are, we are, I think, 1817 with Cauchy and 1923 with Davenport. I mean, Cauchy proved and Davenport just reproved it. And then they both got the name. So the lemma says the following. Let A and B be two sets, non-empty, always, two sets in Z over PZ. So take the integers modulus PZ. So, and P is a prime. Then you have a Brun-Minkowski type inequality, which tells you that the cardinality, so by now the volume means cardinality. Cardinality of A plus B. So you still have A plus B, right, in Z plus PZ. Just do the sum modulus Z of sets. So this is the sum in Z over PZ. And you do the cardinality. This is greater or equal than the minimum between the volume, the cardinality of A plus B minus 1 and P. So what this inequality is telling you, so forget about the minus 1. This inequality is telling you either the volume of A plus B is greater or equal than the volume of A plus the volume of B, which is Brun-Minkowski, or it can be false in the case where this is everything, when the cardinality of A plus B, it's P. So it's the whole group. So either A plus B is the whole group, or you have a Brun-Minkowski inequality. So these are the two possible cases. The proof, it's, in this proof, it's crucial that you have P prime. So proof is by induction. We'll take a, I can give you a reference if you're interested in looking at it. It's by induction on the cardinality of B. So you start with cardinality 1 on cardinality of B. And uses that Z over PZ as no non-trivial subgroups. So the fact is that all the subgroups of Z over PZ is only zero or everything. That's what he uses. And there is an induction over the cardinality of B. It's not completely trivial. I mean, there is a trick here. I mean, it's not a trivial induction. But it's alpha page then once you find the right idea. But let me give this for granted. And let me show you how this lemma gives more or less what we want. So the corollary of this result is this other effect. So now we go to Z, second, let's say, proposition. Let A be a subset of Z now, where the minimum of A is 0, and the max of A is some number P, where P is prime. We want to discuss in a second. If the cardinality of A plus A is less than 3 cardinality of A minus 3, then 0P minus A is less or equal than 2 minus A, yeah, 2, no, A plus A minus 2A plus 1. Okay, it may look ugly, but if you think 1 minute with me, follow me for 1 minute, you will see that it's not that bad. So this is Z, and I have a bunch of points. And I'm assuming the following. So up to a translation, I can always assume that my set starts at 0. So I assume that the first point in A is at 0. Okay, so here I have my first point in A. And then maybe I have other points. And I'm going to assume that the last point in Z is P. And P is a prime. So my set goes from 0 to P. Why I'm doing this? Remember what I said before. I have, in Z, I have arithmetic progressions, which are all the analogs of common sets. But there is only one arithmetic progression which starts from zero and finishes at a prime. So the fact that the last point is a prime ensures me that there is no other arithmetic progression besides 0p. So that's the reason. So this is like zero, the full set is the only convex set which can go from zero to a prime. That's the reason why p prime is important. And then what am I saying? So let's say you where we are going. We want to prove something in R. So when you want to prove something in R, what do? You take your set, you discretize using a billion of intervals. So you cut in a lot of very small intervals. You approximate intervals with points, and then you transport the point in the problem in Z. But once I'm in Z, I will have still billions of points. So my sets are huge. So this means that in this assumption, you can forget about minus 3. Minus 3 is just a small number with respect to billions. And here, plus 1 also is a small number. So morally, what am I saying here? Here I'm saying A plus A strictly less than 3A, which is, so A plus A strictly less than 3A is the same than delta of A strictly less than A, which was my assumption. And here, 0p is all the points, so this is like convex hull of A minus A less or equal than delta of A. So if you forget about the minus 3 and the 1, I'm just, this is exactly the theorem I stated. If the deficit is smaller than the volume of A, then the convex hull of A minus A is less than the deficit, which is Freiman's theorem in R. So this is exactly the same modulus of minus 3 on one side and plus 1 on the other side. So this is really the result in R. I mean, this is almost the result in R. So once we get this, the result in R is very easy. So let's prove it. Let me get. So this I can prove. So proof. Maybe I will see. Okay, so let phi p from z over z over pz be the canonical projection. So you take an integer and you just send it modulus p inside z over pz. Then the observation is that when you have a plus a, so what happens in A plus A? A plus A contains, so 0 is in A, so it contains 0 plus A, and it contains also P plus A. Okay? Because P is also in A. But the point is that when you, so this is nothing else than A, but the point is that these two sets, these and these, when you send them in Z over PZ, they get to the same, because P is equal to 0. So phi p of a plus p, it's equal to phi p of a, which means that when I take a plus a and I map it down to zp, there is a cancellation. One, these two sets collapse to each other. So this fact implies that the cardinality of phi p of a plus a decreases because there is a cancellation, these two copies, which, so these two copies in z, they are almost disjoint. They only have an intersection. There is only one point in common, right? So you have here 0, p, let's say 2p. Here you add a somewhere, and here you have p plus a. You see, in z, these sets have only one point of intersection, but when you map them down, they completely collapse. So the cardinality of this decreases with respect to a plus a by cardinality of A. I may miss somewhere plus 1 or minus 1, but this should be correct. So you have a cancellation of the cardinality. At least one copy of A collapses. And okay, so now my assumption, so we're, let's see. Yeah, my assumption was that I had an assumption. So this implies that Cp of A plus A it's less or equal, so a plus a minus a, and by assumption this was less than 3 a minus 3 minus a. And maybe I, yeah, no, that's correct. So this is 2a minus 3. And now this is the same as 2 phi p of a minus 1. Because when you take a and you map z over into zp, 0 and p collapse to the same point. So you lose 1 point. Right? So the cardinality of this is 1 less than the cardinality of this. So you, here you're using that p of a minus 1. Okay, so we have this, and this is nothing else the same as phi p of a plus phi p of a in zp. So what I discovered? I discovered that since cardinality of phi p of a plus phi p of a in zp is less then twice the cardinality of phi p of a minus 1, you apply Cauchy-Davenport. Cauchy-Davenport inequality tells me the following. This is either greater or equal than this, or greater than p. So since it's strictly less, it must be greater than p. So this implies that the cardinality of phi p of a plus a, which is the same as this, is greater or equal than p. And once you have this, you are done, because you take this and use that one. This tells me that p less or equal a plus a minus a. And check it. This is exactly the statement. This is exactly equivalent as the cardinality of 0p minus a is less or equal than a plus a minus 2a plus 1, which was my statement. So actually, it's very elementary. And also, the other one, as I told you, is not that complicated. So this proved the result for z. How do you do the case of r? So now that we have the dilemma and this proposition, we can do the general case. So proof of Friedmann. Proof of Friedmann is the following. So let's say without loss of generality, I can assume that the convex hull of A is, let's say, is the interval. Now we are back in R, 0m. I'm going to take a sequence pk of numbers converging to plus infinity, primes. So I take a sequence of prime diverging. And then I define ak to be the union of intervals ijk. All the intervals ijk, so I choose only the intervals which intersect. So union over j, so the ijk intersection a is non-empty. And ijk, I take them intervals of the following form. I will draw a picture in a second. So j, m, pk plus 1, j plus 1, m, pk plus 1. So what am I doing? I'm taking the interval 0, m. The convex hull. Without loss of generality, my convex hull, I say, is 0m, just by up to a translation, right? It's an interval, and assuming that it's 0m. So what I'm saying is just the following. You take 0m, and you divide it in intervals, all the same length. And these are pk plus 1 intervals. And then I approximate my set, whatever it was, with a union of intervals of this form. So this is my set EK. Now I take my set AK, which is an approximation of A, and I transport it to Z, in the sense that whenever there is an interval, I get a point. And in this way, so if you define BK to be the set of J's such that IJK is in AK, so you take the indices associated to the interval, then this set BK now is a subset of Z. To this set, you apply the last inequality, so and you discover that 0pk minus bk is less or equal than bk plus bk minus twice bk plus 1. For this one, you have just to check that the fact that the deficit was less than 1 implies that you can apply the last proposition to bk. And then this is exactly the same. So this in terms of cardinality. But if you go back to AK, this is telling you, in terms of AK, that 0m minus AK, so this is equivalent, less or equal than AK plus AK, so delta AK plus 1 over PK plus 1. That's what happens if you just, it's exactly the same. And then you just let K go to infinity. I'm gonna maybe a bit fast, but I think, I mean, you should have all the elements. I mean, you can try to redo by yourself. This part, it's not difficult. You just have to check that all the details are there, but there is no surprise in this proof. So you see, we can get a stability for Brun-Minkowski in one dimension with this method. As I told you, I have no clue how to get a proof, direct proof in R without passing through ZP. Just as a comment, there are a lot of theorems of Friedmann type. So it's something for which there is no obvious analog for in R, or in general in Rn, I wouldn't know. Because the kind of theorem, so this is just really a 1 minute parenthesis. The Friedmann theorem is about stuff of the following form. It tells you, okay, take a set, for instance, so Friedmann type theorems. You take a set in Z, and you look at the cardinality of A plus A. So what do you expect of the cardinality of A plus A? Roughly speaking, the cardinality of A plus A, if you take a random set, should be like A square, if A is kind of random. Right? Because all the possible points you have, it's order A square, because you take all sums, so you have A choices here, and cardinality of A choices for this point, and cardinality of A choices for this one. So all the sums gives you something A square. So here, what we are doing here is kind of an extreme case, because we are really assuming something very strong, that A plus A, cardinality of A plus A is not much more than twice the cardinality of A. But already if you assume, so the assumption that the cardinality of A plus A is bounded by a constant, even large, that's the cardinality of A, is non-trivial if the cardinality of A is large. This is already a very non-trivial assumption. The Friedmann's type theorem, a theorem which tells you, if you give me a large set with billions of points, and you know that the A plus A is less or equal than KA, then I can tell you something about A. For instance, A contains big chunk of arithmetic progressions. It's not a random set. It has some order inside. So this is a non-trivial hypothesis which tells you something about the geometry of these sets. But I wouldn't know how to, I mean, I don't have a real analysis of this in, you can do this not only in Z, but in ZD. I mean, in you can also higher dimension, also ZD. Now, let's go back to our problem. We saw how to do stability for Brzezinski in one dimension. You could wonder what about higher dimension. Actually, we saw only the case A equal B. But you can do also, so the case in one dimension, there is a sharp stability result also when A is equal to B. So theorem, if you take two sets in R, non-empty, and you have if delta of A and B is strictly less than the minimum between the measure of A and the volume of B. So this is now A plus B minus A minus B. Then the convex hull of A minus A is less or equal than delta AB. And convex hull of B minus B is less or equal than delta AB. So there is an analogous, which is passed again through this machinery, but there is an analogous stability result, very sharp, also for different sets. So the question is, what about higher dimension? So there is no result, at least to my knowledge, and to Terence Tao knowledge, which is probably more important, about higher dimensional case in Z. So Z2, Z3, there is nothing. And the issue is that, as I mentioned to you in the proof of the Cauchy-Davenport inequality, you use that Zp as no non-trivial subgroups. Once you go in two dimension, you would have Zp, Zq, and there you always have non-trivial subgroups. So that's the issue. So this is why there is no generalization in higher dimension. So let me state a theorem. So I'm going to state just one of the two theorems we have, the easiest one, for the case A equal B. So if I have A in Rn, non-empty, directly, volume of A equal 1, then there exists constants delta of n and cn positive, such that if delta of A is less than less or equal than delta of n, then convex hull of A, this is with David Jerison. We just did the theorem this year. Less or equal than constant delta of A alpha of n, where alpha of n is some explicit number which I'm not sure I remember. Alpha of n something like 1 over 2 a to the n minus 1 n factorial n minus 1 factorial, something like that. Very nice exponent. No, nice was ironic. It's awful, but so, and we have an analogous result when A and B are different. So, what's the main problem to prove this result? So, this result, so I should mention, remark, in 2012, Mike Rist proved the following fact. Delta of A goes to 0 implies convex hull of A minus A goes to 0. And something analogous for Brzezinski. This is non-trivial. And the main issue that you have with respect to all problems where you have isoperimetric inequalities, so what I mentioned as isoperimetric inequality, the key point was the compactness. Perimeter bounded implies pre-compactness. That was the first class. This compactness is crucial when you want to do argument by per-contradiction. The kind of strategy to prove this, you would say, okay, let me assume that is false. I have a sequence where this goes to 0, but this doesn't go to 0. You would like to extract up a sequence, prove that it converges to something, and prove that in the limit you get a contradiction. But it's very difficult to show that if this goes to 0, your sequence is compact in some sense. The sets are compact in L1. I don't want lock, whatever. It's very difficult because this is not like a derivative, it's not a perimeter. And in particular, you have to think that, so remark, if A is convex, delta of A is zero, but the set of convex sets of volume one is not compact. Right? So I can have a sequence of convex sets which become thinner and thinner. They will not converge to anything, they will just collapse. So this is, in a sense, if you want to prove something like that by contradiction, you have to get rid of this degeneracy. For people who know this, this is handled by a John type lemma argument, but it's non-trivial because we don't know that the sets are convex. And you, so you need to, and then even if you know that your sets are bounded, still you have to show that they are precompact in L1. It's not trivial. I mean, they just have bounded sets. They could oscillate a lot. And so that's something that you have to prevent as well. And this is, and so you have to extract information from delta. Let me just very briefly in, yeah. There is compactness, yeah. It proves that the family of sets where this goes to zero is precompact in L1, up to an affine transformation which gets rid of this degeneracy. And then it gets exactly due by contradiction. But it's, so the proof, it has directly the proof for the Bloom-Minkowski case. And it's done, it has a paper for the two-dimensional case, and then for the n-dimensional case, it has another paper, because it's much more complicated in n-dimension than in two-dimension. So what's the strategy of the proof? So the strategy of proof, okay, if you want to prove a theorem like that, either you give me a proof which it proves in its, inside the proof you also have Friedmann's argument or something which substitutes Friedmann, or you use Friedmann as an inductive step. So since I have no clue how to prove Friedmann directly, we use Friedmann as starting point. So we do by induction over the dimension. At least in this way, the case n equal 1 has been done. So strategy of proof, we start by induction. On the dimension. So you are in a REN, and you assume that you already proved the result up to n minus 1. So you start with a set, let's say A, and you say, okay, I start to take split my space as R and R n minus 1, and I start to look at the intersection of A with lines. So I get something here. And I call this set AY. So AY is A intersection Y cross R. The line passing through Y. So Y is a point in Rn minus 1. And the first observation that you can make is the following. So the observation is that the volume of A plus A minus twice the volume of A, in this way, yeah, let me write in this way. This is nothing other than a fraction. I mean, the deficit I wrote before was, I mean, these are all comparable if the volume is 1. I mean, the deficit before was this. But the volume of A is 1. So these are, if this is small, this is small, and vice versa. So let me start with this. So this is, by Fubini, I can say that the volume of A is the length of each of these sections. So it's the length of AY integrated with respect to Y. So here I have minus, so H1 means the length of the set AY, denoted by H1. So this is the 1D Hausdorff measure. AY. And the same I can do here. I can do the H1 of A plus A over 2, Y. So you take the slice for the other set. Now you can observe, easy exercise, that a plus a over 2y contains ay plus ay over 2. So if you take your set, you slice it with y, you take your set and you do sum of points here, these are going to be a set which is contained in the slice if you take, which is contained a plus a over 2 with coordinate y. So here you can say that this is h1 of ay plus ay over 2 minus h1 of ay. And now to this, you apply the 1D case. You see, this is the deficit in one dimension. The 1D case, which tells you that either this is large or controls the convex hull. So either this is greater or equal than h1 of ay, let's say over 2, or it controls the measure of the convex hull of ay minus ay. So what you discover is something like this, that you intersect with lines, and there are only two possibilities. Either most of the time you get almost an interval, so this is small, or you have enough, you have a lot, some mass. So this guy is greater than this. So you get some, let me just write this estimate. I finished the white chalk, so that's why I'm doing this colored proof. So this is greater or equal than the integral over some, so this is like the bad case, and this is the good case. So I have, when y is bad, I can say that this is greater than h1 of ay over 2, ey. And when y is good, so it's a partition, I partition y to good and bad, I get that this is controls co ay minus ay, h1. So you discover, and this is delta, so this is my function, this is delta. So delta controls this or this. So it tells me that most of the segments either are intervals or they are not, but there are not too many because the integral of this is controlled by delta. So this tells me that my set has some structure. Now, this is the starting point of all the rest, which goes on for a while, where you sometimes you have to start to get, so you have to kill the degeneracy, and so that you have to get rid of these sets very long and thin. So there is, let's say, a bunch of work to show the following, that up to a linear transformation of determinant equal to determinant 1, we can assume A to be bounded. So in a sense, how to do an affine transformation of determinant 1. The point is that determinant 1 transformation do not change the deficit, nor the statement of the theorem. You apply determinant transformation to everything, and the statement is invariant. So you can always do it. Yeah, universally bounded. So bounded, so A is contained some BR, R universal. So there is a, everything is contained in a huge box. And once you're there, so in some sense you get rid of this, so you start to know that your set has some segments, but so in some sense your set is not too, doesn't have many holes, but still you're not that close to convexity. You still, I mean, you could think that your set could be, just to give you an, I don't know, could be kind of weakly, and still maybe it doesn't have many holes. So the fact that it has segments, it's very difficult still to, from there to deduce that you're close to convex. But what you know is that the measure of A plus A over 2 is very close to the measure of A, which tells you something like that. That whenever I take a point in A, X, and another point in A, Y, and I do the convex combination, I take a point, and I can take points all over, and you see that when taking convex combination of points like here, I get another point.
you start to discover, okay, these points should not be too far. I mean, if the measure doesn't increase too much, you cannot have a picture like this, because convex hull of points will fill up a lot of mass inside. And so you end up to prove something like this. And I'm done. Give me just 2 minutes to write this, and then I stop. You would like to prove a statement like this. So, lemma. So let's say that I have a function f from a set E into R. F is bounded, let's say, by capital M. And it satisfies two properties. So that f of x plus f of x prime is less or equal than f of x plus x prime over 2 plus eta for every x, x prime, x plus x prime over 2 in E. So you have a set which satisfies, sorry, this is over 2, which satisfies a kind of concavity inequality with a small error, eta is small, whenever the points are inside the set where the function is defined. And you know that the sets where the function is defined, it's also almost convex. And let's say it's non-trivial. Convex hull, let's say that the convex hull of V, it's contained into BR, and the measure of V is 1. So it's a non-trivial set. So you have a set with measure 1, where the convex hull is very close to it, and you know that for almost all points, I mean, for all points inside, you are almost concave. You satisfy a kind of concavity inequality with a small error. Then there exists a function capital F from the convex hull of V into R, concave, such that the integral over E of little f minus capital F bounded by constant eta to some alpha. So you want to prove that if you are satisfied almost a concavity inequality up to an error in a set which is almost a full measure inside a concave set, a convex set, then you are very close to a concave function. So this is one of the key steps in the proof, where I don't have an elementary proof for it that I can tell you in two lines. It's kind of technical and pretty involved, even long. And in a sense, this is one of the key points which at some moment you're going to apply to show that your profile is very close in L1 to a concave profile, and then you apply it for the bottom part to say that lower profile is also close to a convex profile, to minus, and so your set is close to convex. So if you apply the lemma tells you, it's going to imply that A is close to some K, where K is convex. And from this, you conclude. So I'm out of time, so I stop here. I hope, at least with this part, I didn't enter too much also because it's mostly technical, and I think it's much easier to understand the proofs, the other proofs I gave to you. The point of these problems, especially of this one, is that you see that techniques, even if the statement, final statement stability is always the same, the proof can be very different and can involve different ideas. I found very interesting personally when I saw this connection with additive combinatorics. And I think it would be nice if there could be a direct proof which kind of avoids this additive world. But at the moment it's unknown. So thank you for the attention.